Hello, hello, friends. Welcome to this live training on how to beat burnout. I would love to meet you while we have everyone log in. We have people coming from around the world. So be sure to pop into chat. Tell me who you are, where you're from, so I can at least say hello. You might notice I'm in a very weird location today. I am coming at you from Santa Barbara, California. I had a conference this week and I did not want to cancel my webinar with you. So you'll have to forgive the odd setting. So let's see where everyone else is from. I know that we have a couple hundred people, maybe even more coming on right now, which is wonderful. Hello, hello. So today we're gonna be talking about three steps to beat burnout. Ah, from Latvia. Oh, wow, I knew we'd have some international students too. Minnesota, hello. From India, oh my goodness, from all over. Halifax, Canada, Scotland. Everyone's in the most amazing locations. Barcelona, Sydney, Australia, Detroit, AO, Slovakia, Texas, North Carolina. This is what I love about these trainings. People come from all over. I love it. Florida, Stockholm, Oregon, Amsterdam. Hello from Santa Barbara. Yes. Wonderful. Miami, Ireland, Malaysia. Russia's here as well. Fabulous. Might also tell me why you came here. What brought you here? Are you feeling burnt out? Boy, we're gonna get into it. I'm also gonna talk about some of the hidden reasons we get into burnout. South Carolina, New England, San Diego. I love it. United Kingdom, Firestone, Colorado. Anyone from Santa Barbara? Anyone nearby me? All right, Winnipeg, Canada, Switzerland. Love it. So let me give you a little background on myself and what brings me here to teach this training to you. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Vanessa Van Edwards, and I am the best-selling author of Captivate. And today we're going to be talking about how to beat burnout using science. And that is because I also am a behavioral investigator at Science of People. And our goal is to take the latest, greatest, most amazing science and apply it to high-achieving professional success. How can you use the latest research in your own life, in business, and your personal relationships to be more successful and more fulfilled? Ah, Tate said your content is great. Oh, good. I'm glad you're not burnt out, but I would love to see more warning signs and steer clear of it. If you are here because you are not burnt out yet, double high five. Is that a high 10? High 10, because that means you are investing in preventing it from happening in the future and looking for those warning signs, which I love. I'm so happy you're here. From Mexico. Oh, yay. Caroline said, I loved your book. Thank you so much. Thank you. And this is kind of exciting because today I'm talking about burnout and I wasn't able to talk about any of this science in my books. This is a totally new training that I've never done before because burnout is the biggest reason why professionals feel like they can't succeed in their career. And it often is this slow creep, which we're going to talk about. Oh, I can't get too far into the content yet. All right. Jamie said, wanting to hear about how to get unstuck. We are going to talk about resetting. So when you feel stuck, you feel dread, you feel like you can't get up in the morning, you don't feel excited. And that's one of the killers of productivity. From Arizona, just burnt. I feel you. I feel you. All right, I say let's get started. So I'm going to show us a presentation I've actually never done live before, so I'm very excited to teach it to you today. This is the latest science on burnout. So as I mentioned, I'm going to be talking about the science of how to get unstuck. And what I've found is that this is a slow creep. So these three steps are very tactical, they're very practical, and they'll also help if you're not in burnout yet, but you want to prevent it from happening in the future. Also, for those of you who are here for People School, yes, I promise I will open People School at the end of class. For those of you who've been waiting for a couple of months, we'll do that at the very end. It's kind of our nice reward. So here's what I've learned, and tell me if this feels like you in the chat. The more successful you are, the more likely it is you're going to experience burnout. After the last decade of working with very high achieving people, from CEOs to entrepreneurs to politicians to leaders, the more you push yourself, the more the big goals you have, the more successful you are, the more it is that you might get into burnout. And that's a huge problem because burnout is one of the fastest ways that we destroy our productivity, that we lose motivation, that we feel dread. And dread is the opposite of excitement. And when we're in our careers and we feel excitement, we are more productive. We have more energy and more creativity. So here's how it happens. This is my masterful stick drawing for you so you can see how this happens. And it is a slow creep. With every high professional I've worked with, I've noticed that here's how it goes. They're in their career and they're hustling. So they are building, they're climbing, they're trying new things, they're taking new steps in their career, they're having new success. And then all of a sudden, either a small change, like an industry change or a small career setback begins to happen, or a big change, like they're passed over or they have a job change, they have a new manager, and they hit this plateau. So all of a sudden, all this growth that they've been having, they're used to having, they just begin to slow down a little bit. And what happens is that causes a little bit of frustration, irritation, and high achievers, people who have big goals, don't like slow. Right? High achievers, they want fast. They want to get it all. They want to climb very fast. And so that frustration feels like a step down. And if that's not addressed, they begin to take steps backwards. And that is where you get into a rut. So actually, a rut precedes burnout. And before that, you get a plateau when you feel like you're just not achieving things or hustling as fast as you used to. And that's when you get into the typical symptoms of burnout, which is that you feel stuck, you feel bored with your work, nothing excites you anymore. Things that used to excite you don't excite you anymore. You're resentful of things that you used to like or not mind. And or, worst comes to worst, you dread Mondays. Dreading your work day, not wanting to get up in the morning for work. And those are the typical symptoms of burnout. This is a slow creep. So what I want you to do for a second is I want you to take a look at this graphic and I want you to tell me where you are. So if you're in the climb, the stage where you're like hustling and you're killing it, yes, you are here to prevent those steps from happening. You will be able to now notice a plateau before it becomes a rut, before it becomes burnout. Are you in the plateau? Did something just happen where it was a small change or you were passed over or there was a setback? And you can feel yourself getting a little bit frustrated, a little bit irritated. Or are you in the rut where you're starting to feel that stuck feeling, you're starting to feel resentful? Wherever you are, I want to make sure that now, right now, you're starting to take steps to make sure that you don't get all the way down to the bottom. Okay, people are saying plateau, burnt out, falling off the plateau. So you're about to get into that rut. Yep, absolutely. Burnt out or one step away. So Taja said burnt out or one step away. That is exactly why I'm so glad you're here. What I want you to be able to notice is when you're one step away, so that you can begin to take steps to make sure that you don't actually get into that low dip. Because once you're in that dip, you can get out, but it takes a little bit longer. And here's what I want to tell you. For all of you, or those of you who are saying that you are in that rut or in that plateau, we get into professional ruts with small steps. That means we can get back out of it with small steps. This doesn't mean you have to change your careers. It doesn't mean you have to leave your job. It doesn't mean you have to change something radically. We actually can get out of burnout with small steps. And when I dove into the research of burnout, I was so relieved by that. I was worried that it was going to be something major that was hard to do or expensive to do. But actually, getting out of burnout is very easy to do if you know which steps to take. We get into it with small steps. We can get out of it with small steps. And that means that we can do it even starting today, which is what my goal is. So here are my two big goals for this training. One, I want to give you very powerful but small steps that you can take today to climb back up or to stay in the up. For those of you who mentioned that you were in the climb, I want you to also make sure that you can recognize when you're one step away. And second, I want to give you three ways to hit the reset button. So if you're already in that rut, you're feeling stuck, I want you to be able to hit reset using this training and with these very easy steps. First, congrats on being here. You being here is already the first step. So somehow you saw this maybe on Instagram or you saw it on my newsletter or those of you who read the website or on YouTube, and you recognize that this was a skill that you wanted to have. So major, major kudos on being here. Double high five or high 10 from here, because that is actually the first step, because you recognize there was some aspect of the skill that you wanted. Here's step number one. What most people don't realize is that A, burnout is not a choice. B, that burnout is not made up. When people talk about burnout, they're like, is this even real? Is this stuck feeling something that I'm actually feeling, or is this something in my head? When we look at burnout is actually chemical, and burnout alters your brain. Here is the first study that completely blew my mind and changed my perspective on burnout, and hopefully it will too. I'm hoping that this study will give you some permission to really explore your feelings and know that what you're feeling is real. So this was done by the Stress Research Institute. What they found was they took people who said that they were in burnout, professional burnout, and they did scans of their brain, and they found very distinctly, they could actually see the evidence of burnout in their brain. two areas. They found that people in burnout had an enlarged amygdala and a thinner prefrontal cortex. What does that mean? So that translates into very specific things which you might recognize. People in burnout had these symptoms of enlarged amygdala and a thinner prefrontal cortex. And here is what that causes. When you have these two things, you have more moodiness. You have a stronger stress response. This is really important. That means that when you're in the plateau, when I showed that little down step of moodiness or feeling dread, when you're in the rut, you actually have a greater stress response to stressful things. So an email that you get from a colleague or a client or a manager that used to not bother you, now it bothers you more. That is not made up. That is actually a symptom of a thinner prefrontal cortex. Something happens in your outside environment or your work, and you're like, gosh, that never used to bother me, but I'm really upset by it. That actually because burnout alters your brain. Less cognitive functioning. So if you find it harder to concentrate or you're not as productive as you once were, that is actually because of burnout in your brain. Difficulty learning, lowering creativity, and difficulty with memory and problem solving. I hope that this slide gives you a little bit of relief to know that what you're experiencing is real. It actually is something that happens in the brain. And for those of you who are not in burnout yet, I want you to begin to look out for these signs. These are the signs that things are being altered and that you're getting into that phase of burnout. Here is the good news. So Weill Cornell Medical College took a group of stressed out medical students. Medical students are the best to study for burnout. They're always burned out. I don't know if we have any doctors who are watching, but they know they get burned out the fastest. They took a group of stressed out medical students whose brains already showed many of the burnout impairments. So thinner prefrontal cortex and enlarged amygdala. They put them through an anti-burnout program. And that is exactly what we're doing today. I'm going to give you the exact strategies they used in their anti-burnout program. After only 4 weeks of practicing what they learned in the program, the changes in the brain reversed. This also means that physically they stopped experiencing the negative side effects, especially short attention span and mood swings. This should give you lots of hope. It means that with very simple changes, we can begin to alter or change the trajectory of that burnout. And that can happen with one anti-burnout training program and just being consistent with using it. Are you ready? Are you excited to see this? Okay, here is how we do this. Here is the very basics of an anti-burnout program. It's really hard to just tell someone, stop feeling burnt out, stop feeling stressed, don't worry about it, just calm down. Has anyone ever had that, right? Where you're really stressed out and a non-stressed person tells you, well, just don't stress about it. Does not work, right? For any of my high neurotics watching, if you tell an upset person to calm down, never in the history of calm down has calm down ever helped someone calm down. Same thing with burnout. If you tell someone to stop worrying, stop stressing, or stop being burnt out, it just doesn't work. The better way to do this is to actually take emotion pairs. Anticipation and anxiety are very, very similar emotions if we reframe them that way. So a big aspect of burnout is being anxious, of worrying about things, of not feeling excitement. Anxiety, when you're anxious, you have a faster heart rate, you feel like you wanna move or you're on the edge of your seat. Anticipation is sort of the same way, but it's more positive. Anticipation, your heart beats, you're excited about doing something, you're on the edge of your seat. Very similar emotions, but slightly different positive versus negative feelings. Anticipation is this beautiful emotion that I do not think we cultivate enough. What I love to encourage my students to do is think about anticipation as a secret productivity hack. For all my, do I have any Germans here? Do I have any Germans watching? So I love this German word. I wish we had an English word for this. In German, there's a word called Vorfreude. I hope I said that right. The joyful, intense anticipation that comes from imagining future pleasures. Anticipation is this beautiful emotion that gives you pleasure from a pleasurable thing before you even get that pleasurable thing. And it is the antidote to anxiety. Here's what I want you to think about. In your life, how can you cultivate things that you can anticipate? When you feel anxious, the only way to to stop that anxiousness is not by saying, oh, I shouldn't feel anxious. We know that doesn't work. But it's actually to say, what can I anticipate? And there are three different options. Oh, Zaf said, Eric Kahn is German. Ah, right. Very cool. A little German ancestor here. I don't think, Sven, there's an English word for Vorfreude. If anyone can think of one, you should tell me. Here are the three different things that I want you to think about anticipating from. And if you can, please take out a pen and a paper. So grab a pen and a paper right now. And I want you to write down these three different buckets. And under these buckets, I want you to write down any crazy idea that comes to your head. This is dreamstorming. No one's going to see this. It's just you and me. Here are your three options. First, the big stuff, the vacations, the celebrations, the holidays. Research has found that we get more pleasure out of our vacation before the vacation actually begins. And that is because every time you think about your vacation, you get the pleasure of the anticipation. You actually get pleasure before you experience it. This is one reason that I always try to book my vacations way in advance, just so I can savor the vacation before it even happens. So first, the big stuff. Do you have any big stuff coming up in your life that you can anticipate? Second, the small stuff. I think that we so often don't savor the anticipation from all the small stuff that comes up. Delicious food, a great meal, a great restaurant that you're going to, a new book that you've been dying to read, or a new article that you've been waiting to come out, a new TV show that you know is coming out, or a premiere, or something you've been waiting and waiting to see, or even looking at your Netflix list and seeing what you're excited to watch. Those are small pleasures that we should not throw away. Those are the very small steps that we take towards creating more anticipation, and that is the way that we fight anxiety. And the last one I think is the most important, and I really, really hope that you have something under this bullet. And if you don't, I really encourage you to try to find something, the good stuff. Giving back is one of the fastest ways to create anticipation. Can you help someone today? Can you help someone tomorrow? Are you giving back in some way in the next few weeks or months? Is there a gift that you want to get someone for their birthday that you are so excited to give to them because you know they'll get so much joy from it? And lastly, is there any way that you can feel gratitude for the good things you do have in your life? Those, the good stuff, the giving, the gifting, the gratitude, people don't think of that when it comes to burnout, but that is the fastest way we can add more anticipation into our life in a good way. And that's how we fight anxiety. Here's what I want you to think about, getting really tactical. So take that list that you just made, right? And I want you to see if you can make sure that you have one of each thing in your calendar. So the next thing I want you to do is I want you to actually open up your calendars, open up your phone, open up your calendar and your computer. I want you to make sure that you have one big thing a year. In the next 12 months, is there one big thing you can look forward to? Even if it's a holiday at home, it doesn't have to be a big vacation. I want you to have one good thing a month. So you have to have every month one good thing that you're doing and one small thing a week. This is really a tactical way to add anticipation to your life. And here's why. What do you open more than anything? Maybe social media is more than this, but we open our calendars a lot, right? You open up your calendar, you look at what you have for the day, you look at what you have for the week, you look at what you have for the month. Every single time you open your calendar, if you only have meetings and calls and conferences and networking, that is the surest and fastest way to build dread and anxiety into your brain and your calendar. But if you open your calendar and you have one small thing a week that you're looking forward to, one good thing a month or one big thing a year, you begin to see those things and that turns that anxiety into anticipation. I am hoping that this is going to be a skill you use for life. In my calendar, every single week, every month, every year, I have one of these items. And that is because one, it makes me cultivate steps or cultivate getting one big thing on the calendar, getting one good thing, making sure I'm giving back, making sure I'm giving, and one small thing a week. It's very tactical, but every time you open your calendar, you will see it. And then that becomes an external reminder of your anticipation. This brings me to step number one, which is changing your focus. So we talked about flipping anxiety to anticipation. The next level of this is flipping dread to awe. So dread is a really hard little emotion to beat, but it can be flipped with one of my favorite emotions. And I love, there's so many great research, so many great studies on awe. This was done by Jennifer Steller at UC Berkeley. She has looked at awe as one of the most overlooked positive emotions. I feel like we constantly talk about happiness, but we very rarely talk about awe, and it's one of the fastest ways to happiness. So what she found in a number of different studies is that awe-inspiring experiences boost your immune system. They give you an anti-inflammatory response in your body. They help with depression, and they even lower your risk of heart disease. Talk about the fastest and easiest way to try to help your body. When we're talking about here is chemical. And here's how we get awe. Awe comes from those moments we feel like we've learned something. For those of you who take my courses or have read any of my books, you know I am obsessed with aha moments. In Captivate, I ask you after every chapter, what was your biggest aha moment? The reason for this, there's a secret reason I have for this. It's because I'm trying to get you to cultivate that feeling of awe. An aha moment is that moment where you're like, ah, that makes sense. Or yeah, I didn't realize that before. It's literally your brain creating some kind of spark, and that's where awe comes from. So what I want you to create next, so the very first thing we did is we created our calendar with the three good, big, and small things. The next thing I want you to do is create a learning bucket list. Everyone should have a learning bucket list. These are all the skills and ideas and topics and things you want to learn about in your lifetime. So here are the three questions I want you to learn. So I want you to pull out another piece of paper, and I want you to answer these questions. One, what is something you have always wanted to learn? And think crazy, dream big. Two, what is something you have always wanted to try? So not even learn, just try. Like, did you want to ever try skydiving? Did you ever want to try making sushi? Did you ever want to try gardening for the first time? Whatever it is there ever something you wanted to try? And three, what are all the skills you want to learn in your lifetime? And that's a really big one. Hopefully you can take some time to dreamstorm on that. Someone said my camera ratio isn't so good. Camera aspect ratio 16 to 9. We want 4.3. 16 to 9. Display webcam over presentation. Should I take that away? All right. Sorry about that. If my aspect ratio is being a little funky. All right. Elsie said, what if my list is endless? I love it. I love that you have so many that you can't even see an end. The more skills you have on that list, the more anticipation you have to learn them, and the more excitement you have to try to acquire them. Here's my goal. I want you to try one new skill a month. So this is really important. If you know that you're learning a new skill or you're acquiring your skill, it literally flips your mind into aha moments, into awe, into growth mindset. And for anyone who studies Carol Dweck, Carol Dweck is an incredible researcher who has found that as we are growing, that actually changes our brain. So some ideas: read one new book a month, learn one new thing a month, take one new class a month, watch one new video a month. Is there an educational YouTube channel that you want to watch? Is there a book club that you want to join? I want you to have one of these things on your calendar so when you open up your calendar, you see it. Next one, step three, creating mastery. So I know I'm going through these very fast. The reason is because I wanted to get you all these tools. You can always rewatch or pause if you need to. These are the skills that are going to help you prevent those small steps. This is about flipping boredom to capability. So in burnout, you feel anticipation. I'm sorry, you feel anxiety, which I want to be anticipation. You feel dread, which I want to be awe. And the other big symptom of burnout is boredom or listlessness or feeling like I don't care about things I used to care about. The best way to flip boredom is to turn it into capability. And capability is a wonderfully powerful emotion. When we talk about confidence, I actually prefer to talk about capability. One of my favorite quotes by Abraham Maslow, if you plan on being anything less than you are capable of being, you will probably be unhappy all the days of your life. So what I want to ask you, and just take a moment and answer this for yourself. Are you being what you are capable of being? Are you taking advantage of all your capabilities? Are you activating your potential? When we are in a rut, those first few steps down, I've noticed over and over again that professionals, it's when they are not activating their full potential. When they know they could be doing more, they know they're capable of a little more, they know they're capable of learning more, but something is holding them back or they are not learning as much as they can do. This is why I wanted you to create a learning bucket list. Here's the last thing I want you to do. And humility is not welcome here. I actually want you to brag about yourself to yourself for just a second, just a second. And if you really feel brave, you can even put it in the chat. I want you to fill in the blank, your next piece of paper or your chat. I am amazing at brag about yourself to yourself. My strengths are specifically, what are you good at that you know that other people aren't always good at? I want you to put those in there. I'm amazing at, my strengths are. These are the feelings of capability. And here's how this works. Sometimes doers, I don't know if I have any doers. You're the ones who love your to-do list. You love being productive. You like getting things done. You like hustling. You like building. You like climbing. If you're a doer, sometimes you can get into the place where you're doing things because you should do them, not because they're your best things. I call this A work, B work, C work. For those of you on YouTube, I have a video called Alphabet Work. Our A work is our work that makes us feel capable and masterful. Our B work, we feel pretty good at it, but it's not our best work. And C work is stuff we can get by with doing, but it doesn't really fulfill us. It doesn't really feel like our best work. Doers get in the trap of doing their B, C, and sometimes D work because they want to get stuff done. What I actually want you to think about is only doing your A work, or at least doing your A work in a planned manner. So exercise one of your strengths daily. I want you to open up your to-do list, literally look at your to-do list for the day. And I want you to check and see against that list of I'm amazing at, my strengths are you utilizing anything that you're amazing at or any of your strengths in your to-do list today? If you are not, it means that you are missing feelings of mastery. You are missing feelings of capability. And that is the fastest way to get into burnout. If you're not doing your A work, if you don't feel capable or masterful, you get burnt out faster doing B, C, and D work. So I want you to make sure that you are doing a strength, at least one strength once a day in your to-do list. Second, the next level up from just your strengths are your superpowers. So when I asked you, I'm amazing at, a superpower is something that you feel like, wow, I am better than most people at this particular skill. You should be utilizing that skill at least once a month. That's called your superpower. And lastly, you should be adopting one new professional skill and one new interpersonal skill every year. Every year, you should be able to tell me, you know what? 2019, I mastered this professional skill and this interpersonal skill. In 2020, I want to learn this interpersonal skill and this professional skill. The most masterful people are constantly acquiring new skills because then they have even more to feel masterful about. And the best part about this is when you're acquiring new skills, you might discover that you're amazing at something you didn't even realize you were amazing at. So if you had trouble with that exercise, I'm amazing at, my strengths are. Does anyone have trouble with this, where you felt like you couldn't fill in the blank? If you couldn't fill in the blank for I'm amazing at or my strengths are, this is the slide that's important for you. That means you have to try new skills to find what you are naturally amazing at. What's crazy is as adults, we forget that we can still learn new skills. In high school or in college, we learned all these skills and we thought, okay, that's my skill set. I'm good at English, I'm bad at math, right? How often did this happen? I take advanced science classes, but I don't do foreign language classes. And then you decide that for the rest of your life. What I actually want you to encourage you to think about is you actually can reevaluate your skills every year and you might rediscover something that you didn't even know you were good at. I want you to do two of these skills a year, one professional skill, one interpersonal skill. One professional skill, time management, conflict resolution, motivation, programming, marketing, organization. Those are all professional skills. I want you to try to pick one you can do per year. And then interpersonal skills, leadership, public speaking, teamwork, collaboration, pitching, negotiation. Every interpersonal skill exercises a different part of your brain. And you might realize, wow, I didn't realize I was actually better at that people skill than I realized. No one knows this more than me. And I love the research on this. So Carnegie Institute of Technology found that 15% of our financial success is due to technical ability, which is way less than most people think. And 85% of our financial success is due to people skills. The reason why I want you to acquire both is because we often forget about the people skills. And those of you who follow my work know that I talk about this all the time. We don't realize how powerful our people skills are. High PQ earners, people with high interpersonal intelligence, make an average of $29,000 more per year because of their high PQ. And that is because I've found that people skills are like a social lubricant. They make everything easier. If you are a master conversationalist, you can talk to clients easier. You can build rapport with your boss easier. You can make chit chat with colleagues. It makes networking easier. It makes negotiations easier. And so the reason why I want you to adopt both technical and interpersonal skills is because they help you in everything. So I have spent the last 12 years researching interpersonal skills. We have a database of over 2,500 studies. We pull all these interesting research on interpersonal intelligence, or PQ. I have bought every single course, book, and seminar there is on interpersonal intelligence. And what I found is that it is a universal career skill. So if you want to feel more mastery, if you want to feel more capability, if you had trouble answering those questions about your strengths, it might be that you need to level up your people skills. And here it finally is. For those of you who have been waiting for this Casa of People School, I am now opening up People School. We are open, right? We are open. Great. So I only open People School a couple of times a year. People School, for those of you who don't know, is our advanced training program. It is completely virtual. It is online, where I teach you the 12 most advanced people skills for high achieving professionals. And I specifically designed this for very busy people. It's hard to learn a new skill, right? If you looked at that calendar and you were like, I don't know how I'm going to have time to learn a new skill. The key here is making sure that you can learn anytime, anywhere. So we made People School completely virtual. You have lifetime access to it. You can watch it on any device. We also recently added audio versions of all of our training, so you can also listen to it as well as watch it. So here's how it works. People School, very simply. First, when you enroll, you get an amazing workbook. This is your guide. You also get some surprises in the mail, a little bit of swag in there. So you get an amazing workbook. This is over 150 pages of all my exercises and templates and blueprints. Each of these skills goes with a video training module. So each advanced people skill has a video training module. And here's how the video training modules work. Every video starts with the science. What is the latest research on this people skill? Then I teach you a framework to be able to apply it in real life. Just like I did today in this seminar, I taught you the science of burnout and then how to activate that science in your life. And then lastly, what is a strategy for actually applying it to reach your goals? And we're going to talk about goals in a second, why they're so important for People School. In this, I'm trying to give you insurance, a people toolbox that wherever you go in your career, you can always have access to not only People School, but the tools, conversation blueprints with bosses and clients and colleagues and investors and friends and partners, elevator pitch formulas, interaction roadmaps. We have charisma quizzes, pattern recognition exercises, amazing toolbox that you can just use whenever you have that come up in your career. So even if you're not using, say, the pre-event checklist now, you might be able to use that later. We also, of course, have lots of fun things like trivia and games and warm-ups. I believe learning should be fun. That's the best way to learn. So if people just want to buy the workbook, by the way, we don't even sell the workbook to anyone publicly. Companies buy our workbook for $3,000, just those exercises and templates. We obviously have done this training for many, many amazing companies. I'm so lucky to do corporate trainings for amazing individuals from HR to engineers to C-suite to leaders to new managers. And everything you're learning in People School is exactly what I teach in these corporate trainings plus. So I was actually able to go a lot deeper in this training because I was able to apply it to you. We actually have a live audience that you watch. They take live question and answer. And if you're wondering who People School is for, we have three basic buckets of our People School students. First, we have entrepreneurs who are building their business, who are wanting to learn how to pitch themselves, negotiate, interact. We also have entrepreneurs, new managers, people who are just killing it in the professional world, who work at Fortune 500 companies, Fortune 1000 companies, who are wanting to level up in their current company. And we teach them a lot of skills for leveling up within their company. And then we also have this last bucket, so kind of a fun bucket of pivoters, people who are thinking about something different. They're not quite sure what they want to do in their career, but they're thinking about something different, and they take People School for inspiration to see what might be next. So when I do corporate trainings for just an hour, that I charge $15,000 for just an hour to go in and do three or four of these people skills, all 12. I think we have over 15 hours of content, over 30 hours of content in People School, if you count all of the office hours and bonuses, which I'm going to talk about in a second. So after the workbook, after the video training modules, the next big piece of People School is live office hours. This is where I actually get to work with you. So I give you feedback on your elevator pitches, your log lines. I answer your questions. I look at your business cards. I do a bunch of group coaching. You also have the option of doing 13 bonus assignments to activate your skills as well. And I love looking at your bonus assignments as well. So log lines, elevator pitches, negotiation strategies. This is where I really get to know you and help you with your goals. This is the most important part of People School. The very first thing you do when you get into People School is I ask you, what is the one goal that you want to achieve with People School? what in the next few weeks can I help you achieve? And these range, we get so many interesting examples. Landing 3 new clients, asking for a 20% raise, adding 100 high quality network contacts to my network. So they really, really range from all different kinds of goals. And my goal is to show you how people skills can help you get your goal. And that's what I try to help you with all throughout People School. My favorite part of People School is when I get the email that our students have achieved their goal. And we get these every week now. Got the job, 30,000 more per year, less hours, more vacation. This is the first time in review that I got a performance review that I loved. Those are my favorite emails. My goal is that you come with your goal and that by the end of the program, you've actually achieved it. You can let me know and I can celebrate with you. I love celebrating goals during People School office hours. So the workbook, the corporate training, live coaching. By the way, I actually don't even do any live coaching anymore. People School is the only way I do coaching. We have all the assignments, all the bonuses, which I'll talk about in a second, as well as a proof of completion certificate. So when you finish the program, you actually get a proof of completion certificate, which you can talk to your manager about. And then, of course, a little secret swag bag. So if you were a company and you wanted to get this for just 1 hour, that would be $18,000. Of course, I am not going to charge that for you. My big goal for People School was to make it affordable so that everyone could take this and add these skills to their toolbox. So the price of People School is $14.95. That is all inclusive. It never expires. And by the way, if you come in and you're like, you know what? It's not for me. We have a 30-day 100% money back guarantee. I really, really want People School to be the way that you hit your reset button. I want you to be able to use every single bonus to feel masterful and capable. And in fact, if I don't cover a topic in People School, I like to film those bonuses. So I'm constantly adding to the bonuses based on your needs. So if I see a goal and I'm like, ooh, I don't think we cover that directly, I want to film the bonuses. Here are the bonuses that we have. We have a getting your raise bonus, which I added. So how to actually ask for your raise with a formula to ask for your raise or raise your rates. So if you're an entrepreneur and you want to raise your rates, I have a formula for that. If you're an entrepreneur and you want to get a raise, I have a formula for that. Cold approaching, finding your people. We have pre-event meditations. I have a conversation swipe file if you want some of my favorite conversation starters and conversation activators, which are a little bit different. I have some of my secret favorite resources. I also, for those of you who love Captivate, I have a secret bonus chapter 15 that I give to all of our People School students and many, many more. My goal is for this to be the reset button. Whether you take People School or not, you're in this training, these skills can help you hit the reset button. If you begin to turn anxiety into anticipation, to turn dread into awe, to turn boredom into capability, that's how you begin to reactivate your brain in that anti-burnout program. It just takes consistency and practice. So I'm hoping that today I've given you a little bit of motivation, hopefully some really hard skills to actually hit the reset button. My number one goal is for you to feel happy in your career, to feel more successful, to use this amazing science that's out there to be more successful. I would love, love to have you in People School. I'm so excited because the very first thing that you do is you enter your goal into your People School comments, and I'm right there waiting to give you feedback and talk to you and give you challenges. And we have our first office hours coming up for this class next week. So be sure that if you're going to enroll, you enroll soon so you can come to our first office hours and I can welcome you and say hello. I want to thank everyone for joining this webinar. It's been such a pleasure to teach this science. Again, I've never taught this science before in a live training, and I think it's extremely important for every professional to have in their toolbox. So I want to say thank you. Have a great day. Thanks for all your chat comments, and hopefully I will see you in People School. All right. Bye, everyone.